Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Good evening, God bless you and all yours richly. And may the peace of God that passes all understanding fill your hearts and minds. And may the God of peace be with you now and always. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Welcome to another exciting edition of our online City Impact Bible Study. From Wednesday, the 25th of March, when the lockdown was first announced, till today, the 24th of June, we've heard 14 straight sessions of Bible study, today's inclusive, by the grace of God. Tonight, we are at our own Mizpah intersection. For those who know, it was at Mizpah that Prophet Samuel set up a memorial stone he called Ebenezer, meaning, thus far the Lord has helped us. Let's see the story in 1 Samuel 7, for those who don't know. 1 Samuel 7, verse 3 to 12. Then Samuel spoke to all the house of Israel, saying, if you return to the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the foreign gods and the Ashtoreths from among you, and prepare your heart for the Lord, and serve him only, and he will deliver you from the hand of the Philistines. So the children of Israel put away the Baals and the Ashtoreths and served the Lord only. And Samuel said, gather all Israel to Mizpah, and I will pray to the Lord for you. So they gathered together at Mizpah, drew water, poured it out before the Lord, and they fasted that day and said, there, we have sinned against the Lord. And Samuel judged the children of Israel at Mizpah. Now when the Philistines heard that the children of Israel had gathered together at Mizpah, the lords of the Philistines went up against Israel. And when the children of Israel heard of it, they were afraid of the Philistines. So the children of Israel said to Samuel, do not cease to cry out to the Lord our God for us, that he may save us from the hand of the Philistines. And Samuel took a suckling lamb and offered it as a whole burnt offering to the Lord. Then Samuel cried out to the Lord for Israel, and the Lord answered him. Now, as Samuel was offering up the burnt offering, the Philistines drew near to battle against Israel. But the Lord thundered with a loud thunder upon the Philistines that day, and so confused them that they were overcome before Israel. And the men of Israel went out of Mizpah and pursued the Philistines. You see, the one who were afraid before now received strength. Pursued the Philistines and drove them back as far as below Bethkar. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen and called its name Ebenezer, saying, thus far the Lord has helped us. I will share more with you on Israel's journey to Mizpah under the leadership of Prophet Samuel during the communion service next Friday, the 26th of June, by God's grace. Mark that in your calendar. Our monthly virtual communion service will take place on Friday at 7 p.m. Please note that from Wednesday, next Wednesday, 1st of July, 2020, and that's why we are erecting a memorial stone tonight, thus far the Lord has helped us. From Wednesday, 1st of July, 2020, I'll be taking a back seat as your servant overseer. Now, that does not mean I'm resigning my office. That's not what I mean. But I will take a back seat in order to make room for our pastors and elders to contribute their own God-given quota for the keeping of the saints, for their work of ministry, especially in this season. God willing, I will continue to anchor the last weekend of every month with communion service on the last Friday of every month at 7 p.m., prophetic intercession and healing service on the last Saturday of the month at 10 a.m., and combined Thanksgiving service in the cloud on the last Sunday of the month at 10 a.m., also beginning from July till the lockdown is over. Please take note of that. The last Friday of every month will be our time for communion at 7 p.m. On Saturday morning, Around breakfast time, we'll have the healing service and prophetic intercession. And the Sunday following, that weekend completely, we'll have a combined Thanksgiving service in the cloud at 10 a.m. I can assure you that the ministry of the word and prayers will only get better and richer by the grace of God. And may the good Lord give us an unprecedented increase in the days to come by our collective efforts, yours and ours, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Tonight we shall continue where we stopped last Wednesday with part two of the conceptual and operational definition of the church, with a special focus on the journey between and beyond Bethel. The journey of the patriarch Jacob between Bethel and beyond Bethel. You will recall that last week we pointed out that on the two occasions that the Lord Jesus mentioned the word church in the book of Matthew, before his crucifixion and his resurrection, he did not define the church. He just mentioned it. First, in Matthew 16, from verse 13 to 19, he said, I will build my church. Let's read it again. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said to him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Underline that. In this reference, he's not referring to the Citadel Global Community Church, or the Redeemed Christian Church of God, or the Deeper Life Bible Ministry or Bible Church, or the First Square. He's referring to the global church without any specific nomenclature. I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. This was the first place the Lord Jesus mentioned the word church. He never defined it. Moreover, in the reference, the next reference, which relates to the local expression of the church, you find that in Matthew chapter 18, verse 18 to 20, that's where the different assemblies, local assemblies, no matter how many they are, each one with its own unique name and unique features, this is where the reference to local church came next, and he never defined the church at all. Matthew 18, 18 to 20. Assuredly, I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I say to you that if two of you shall agree on earth concerning anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm there in the midst of them. Now, in that portion, you will not see the word church. I want you to see the word church there. Matthew chapter 18, reference is made to church there also. Matthew 18, I would like to read from verse 15 so that you know it's talking about the local church. Matthew 18, verse number 15. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, that cannot happen at global level. This would be at local level. Moreover, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he hears you, you have gained your brother. But if he will not hear, take with you one or two more, that by the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word may be established. And if he refuses to hear them, tell it to the church. That's the local church. It's not asking you to go to Rome to report to the Pope, or to go to London to report to the Archbishop of Canterbury. No, tell it to the church. That's the local church. But if he refuses even to hear the church, let him be to you like a heathen and a tax collector. And what he said in respect of the global church, he also said now about the local church. Surely I say to you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth will be loosed in heaven. And then again I say unto you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Verse 20, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, I'm there in the midst of them. Those who are really concerned about congregational worship, that the Bible says must not forsake the assembly of one another, had forgotten that the quorum for the church is where two or three are gathered together in my name. Thank God for congregational worship. We pray that time we come again. And even if it doesn't return, the church in China went underground for so many years. It came out better and stronger when the power of communism was broken, and it's still being broken at this hour. The same thing happened in Russia. No one can kill the church, and no one can shut the church down. You can shut the building, but you can't shut the church, because the church is marching on, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Always remember that the quorum is where two or three are gathered together in my name. He promised to be there in the midst of them. Even at that, either in Matthew 16, 13 to 19, where the global church was reverenced, or Matthew 18, 18 to 20, where the Lord reverenced the local church, he did not define the church. It was Apostle Paul who subsequently gave us this conceptual definition of the church in his letter to Timothy, where he used three major phrases to describe the church. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 to 15. I hope you're following me with understanding today, because when you don't understand what the church is, you cannot keen to the plan and purpose of God. And when purpose is not known, abuse is inevitable. 1 Timothy chapter 3, 14 and 15. These things I write to you, though I hope to come to you shortly. But if I'm delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself, listen to the description, in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. There you have it. Apostle Paul alluded to the fact that the house of God is the church of the living God, and it is the pillar and the ground of truth. I take that one more time. The house of God is the church of the living God, and it is the pillar and the ground of truth. You may want to ask the question, how did Paul come by this definition of the church? The house of God, the church of the living God, the ground, the pillar and the ground of truth. Well, this definition of the church by Apostle Paul is traceable back to the God encounter that Jacob the patriarch had on his way to Paddan Aram in search of a wife. Genesis chapter 28, verse 16 to 19. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep. You know how he came to a certain place, and he took a stone from there and used it for a pillow. And then he had a dream. But when he awoke from his sleep, he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. That was the first definition that Paul referred to. The house of God, which is the church of the living God, the ground and the pillar of truth. This is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. Those of you who want to go and knock at the gate of heaven, when you get there, please greet them. The gate of heaven is here on earth. Sorry to disappoint you. Then Jacob arose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel, but the name of that city had been Luz previously. I just said something that someone would take out of context tomorrow and say, Pastor Bakare said the gate of heaven is on earth. Yes, the place of his manifest presence is a gate. That's the opening. That's the access for you on earth to to see and to know what is happening in heaven. And by the way, the heavenly Jerusalem, the city that is descending from heaven to the earth, is the one that the Bible describes as having gates and having foundation. But let's not go there and be distracted. Here we find in the portion of the scripture just quoted, the house of God, the gate of heaven, and then the pillar that was set up. It was a stone that he used as pillow. Now he erected it as a pillar and he poured oil on it, and it entered into vow with God. We all know that what made this certain place to become an awesome place, as well as the house of God and the gate of heaven and the pillar and the ground of truth, is a manifest presence of God that Jacob encountered in his dream. Write this down in capital letters and don't ever forget it. A church without the presence of God is not only the congregation of the dead, it's also either a personality cult or the synagogue of Satan. I take it again. A church without the presence of God is not only the congregation of the dead, it's also likely a personality cult or the synagogue of Satan. It is very clear from the scriptures that when leaders and their followers commit abominations in the house of the Lord, God will go far away from his sanctuary. Maybe you don't know that. You can have good music. You can be jumping and dancing. You might jolly well be doing it and worshiping before Satan, because he has his own throne in such environment wherever the presence of God is not. Why? There's no vacuum in nature. Whenever the followers and the leaders commit abominations in the house of the Lord, God will go far away from his sanctuary. 2 Chronicles chapter 15, verse 1 to 7. Now the Spirit of God came upon Azariah, the son of Oded, and he went out to meet Asa, that was the king of Israel, and said to him, "Hear me, Asa," I beg your pardon, the king of Judah. "Hear me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin. The Lord is with you while you are with him. If you seek him, he'll be found by you. Two people God will not forsake: those who do not know God but are seeking him, and those who know him and are crying unto him day and night. If you seek him, he'll be found by you, but if you forsake him, he will forsake you." Verse 3, "For a long time," wow, "for a long time, Israel has been without the true God." Where you don't find the true God, you'll find false gods. "Israel has been without the true God, without a teaching priest, and without law." And what followed? "But when in their trouble they turned to the Lord God of Israel and sought him, he was found by them. But before they will find him," see what will happen. "In those times there was no peace to the one who went out, nor to the one who came in, but great turmoil was on all the inhabitants of the lands. So nation was destroyed by nation, and city by city, for God troubled them with every adversity. But you be strong, and do not let your hands be weak, for your work shall be rewarded." Let's look at Ezekiel chapter 8 and see. Here we read in 2 Chronicles that for a long time Israel had been without a true God, so there must be a false God in the temple as people gathered unto him. Ezekiel chapter 8, verse 1 to 18, a long read there, but I will take my time. There's a reason for it. When leaders and followers commit abomination in the house of God, God will go far away from his sanctuary. Listen to the word of God. "And it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day of the month," God is being specific here so that you know exactly when it took place, "as I sat in my house with the elders of Judah sitting before me, that the hand of the Lord God fell upon me there. The elders came to consult the prophet, but while they were talking to him, God took him away in a vision to let him see the abominations these hypocritical elders who sat before the prophet, the abominations they were committing in the temple. Then I looked, there was a likeness like the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his waist and downward fire, and from his waist and upward like the appearance of brightness, like the color of amber. He stretched out the form of a hand and took me by a lock of my hair And the Spirit lifted me up between earth and heaven and brought me in visions of God to Jerusalem. Remember, the elders were still sitting before him, hypocritical elders. They did not know that God had opened the eyes of the prophet to see the abominations they were perpetrating. He brought me in visions of God to Jerusalem, to the door of the north gate of the inner court, where the seat of the image of jealousy was, which provokes to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the God of Israel was there, like the vision that I saw in the plain. Then he said to me, Son of man, lift your eyes now toward the north. So I lifted my eyes toward the north, and there, not of the altar gate, was this image of jealousy in the entrance. So how many images are we going to have in the temple? Furthermore, he said to me, Son of man, do you see what they are doing? The great abominations that the house of Israel commits here to make me go far away from my sanctuary. Now turn again, you will see greater abominations. So he brought me to the door of the court. And when I looked, there was a hole in the wall. Then he said to me, Son of man, dig into the wall. And when I dug into the wall, there was a door. And he said to me, go in and see the wicked abominations which they are doing there. So I went in and saw, and there every sort of creeping thing, wow, abominable beasts, and all the idols of the house of Israel portrayed all around on the walls. That's why sometimes when I get into churches and I see all kinds of images, I just shut my face and shut my spirit, because behind every art, there is a voice. And I don't know where we got our photograph of Jesus Christ from that we display in our homes and churches. The man who took part in a film had already asked the whole world to stop using his image. And yet we still decorate our churches and our houses with such images. We see Jesus and his 11 apostles. Who took their photograph? Who took the photograph of Mary? But we deceive the people. And we give them a semblance of false image, and they look unto Mary and say, Hail Mary, Mother of Jesus. That's not true. Those are false, abominable pictures that we display in our homes and churches. And there stood before them, watch this, 70 men of the elders of the house of Israel. And in their midst stood Jezaniah, the son of Shaphan. Each man had a censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up. Please stop there. A thick cloud of incense represents the prayers of saints. Many of you are misguided that wherever prayer is going on and people are shaking like weather-beaten chicken and they are saying all kinds of things, there must be God there. No! You don't have to scream to pray. Jesus didn't have to shout at demons for them to flee. There stood before them 70 men of the elders of the house of Israel. And there midst stood Jezaniah, the son of Shaphan. Each man had a censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went to a prayer pretense. The whole world is, oh, there is prayer there. Oh, people are praying there. But for the mercy of the Lord, many of such places would have been wiped out a long time ago because of the secret and damnable things done in secret. Then he said to me, Son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel do in the dark? Every man in the room of his idols, and you don't know, many of them have delved into divination, which you consider revelation, because you cannot separate magic from miracle. Every man in the room of his idols, for they say, the Lord does not see us. The Lord has forsaken the land. And he said to me, turn again, and you see greater abominations that they are doing. So he brought me to the door of the north gate of the Lord's house. And to my dismay, these were followers. Women were sitting there weeping for Tammuz. You ask the question, who's Tammuz? The fertility god. The fertility god of abominable. You know, when women are desperate looking for children, they will go anywhere. The other day, I saw a church signboard. I laughed. He said, come here and you will get twins. Jacob the patriarch told Rachel, am I in the place of God to make babies? Do you know the way bones are formed in the womb of whom, of her who is with child? We don't know, but we deceive these people. Many of these people are worshippers of Tammuz, the fertility god. Then he said to me, have you seen this, O son of man? Turn again. You will see greater abominations than this, all in the temple. So he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house, and there at the door of the temple of the Lord, between the porch and the altar, where priests should be crying for the sins of the people and for their own sins too, were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord. They turned their back to God and their faces toward the east, and they were worshiping the sun toward the east. They were gathering energy from the sun. No wonder God says in the last days he will pour his spirit upon his flesh. The sun will become like blood and the moon will be darkened. The power of the occult and the power of half crescent moon will be destroyed in the name of Jesus, so that the glory of the Lord will be seen all over the world as the waters cover the seas. And he said to me, have you seen this, O son of man? Is it a trivial thing to the house of Judah to commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence. Can you see that violence is coming from corrupt practices and mixture going on in the church? For they have filled the land with violence, and they have returned to provoke me to anger. Indeed, they put the branch to their nose. Therefore, I also will act in fury. My eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. And though they cry in my ears with a loud voice, I will not hear them. Wow. Brothers and sisters, it is the presence of God that makes Bethel the house of God. Please recall, there was no physical building when Jacob erected his first pillar. Any building without the presence of God, no matter how magnificent and no matter what labor you put on it, any building without the presence of God does not count as the house of God. At a very personal level, I'd like to tell you that it was God's presence in the life of Joseph that distinguished him from the others in the house of Captain Potiphar. The same presence of God was evident in his life when he was thrown into prison unjustly for the crime he did not commit. Let's look at Genesis chapter 39, verse 1 to 6. We have seen corporate worship and the abomination in the temple, but where God was far away from there. And yet to one man called Jacob, God manifested his presence, and he called the place the house of God without any building. Now, at personal level, let's look at the life of Joseph. We'll look at the life of Daniel. We'll look at the life of David. And you see the difference between those who pretend to be Christians and those who are real sons of God led by Spirit. Now, Joseph had been taken down to Egypt, and Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh, captain of the guard, an Egyptian, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him down there. The Lord was with Joseph. That's the presence of God. And he was a successful man. He was a slave. He had no dime in his bank account. He had no luxury vehicles. He had no building of his own. He was a slave living in the house of Captain Potiphar. But the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a successful man. What's your definition of success? Rolex wristwatches, Rolls Royce car, apartment in Banana Island. He was in the house of his master, the Egyptian. He had no account. And God says he was a successful man because of his presence. The presence of God in your life is what makes the difference, not material mesmerism and material acquisition. And his master saw, it can be seen, the presence of God can be clearly evident. And his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord made all he did to prosper in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and served him. Then he made him overseer. Watch. He was a slave, but he had become overseer. Why? Because of the presence of God. Then he made him overseer of his house, and all that he heard, he put under his authority. So it was from the time that he had made him overseer of his house, and all that he heard, that the Lord blessed Egyptians' house for Joseph's sake, and the blessing of the Lord was on all that he heard in the house and in the field. Who would not hire such a man? Jobs are not scarce. Only faithful who carry the presence of God, the faithful men and women who carry the presence of God are rare. Thus he left all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he did not know what he had except for the bread which he had. Now Joseph was handsome in form and appearance. A beauty was radiating from inside. He was handsome in form and appearance, but that became a professional hazard. You know how the wife of Captain Potiphar now wanted to sleep with him at all costs, but he refused. You know the rest of the story, how he wanted to rape him in the house and the man fled. And he took his garment to convict him for a crime he did not commit. And then they threw him into prison. What happened in prison? See again, Genesis chapter 39, verse 20 to 23. Genesis 39, 20 to 23. Then Joseph's master took him and put him into the prison, a place where the king's prisoners were confined. And he was there in the prison. Guess what? But the Lord was with Joseph. I can't do without this God. This God will be my God forever. It will be my guide even unto death. He will go everywhere with you when you pass through the waters, when you pass through the fire, when you go through the rivers. He said, I will not forsake you. I've created you for my glory. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him mercy. And he gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. And the keeper of the prison committed to Joseph's hand. He was a prisoner, not a warder. But he committed to Joseph's hand all the prisoners who were in the prison. Whatever they did there, it was his doing. The keeper of the prison did not look into anything that was under Joseph's authority. Why? Because the Lord was with him, and whatever he did, the Lord made it to prosper, even in prison. Would you like to know that it was the presence of God in Joseph's life that produced not just the accurate interpretation of Pharaoh's dreams, but the economic blueprint he brought out of those dreams? Let me share something with you today. You may be going through a hard time. You might be going through false accusations and all kinds of things, and you are already overwhelmed, and you are getting to the place of depression. Wake up and smell the coffee. It's part of the process. No process, no progress. Have you suffered setbacks? Show me any beautiful building without setbacks. Setbacks are necessary in your life to evaluate, reevaluate, and think, and let God propel you to where he's taking you to. If Joseph had not been taken to prison, he would remain a slave forever. But the day he was thrown into prison, he became the subject of the state. That's why Pharaoh could send for him and promote him, because he was no longer a slave of his master. He was now a subject of the state. And the time in prison was not solitary confinement. The Lord was with him. It was solitary refinement. By the time he was refined and he stood before Pharaoh at the age of 30, the rest is history. Don't be in a hurry. It was the presence of God in the life of Joseph that catapulted him into power. Write this in capital letters, because things are going to happen in this nation that will shock you. It was the presence of God in the life of Joseph that catapulted Joseph into power. Not God fatherism, not political party. Somebody asked me a question. Do you really want to contest election? When did I tell you that? Are you really running for the presidency? I'm not a runner. What party are you going to use? I said, the right question is, what party is going to use me? Because when the fullness of time comes, they will look for the man who can deliver the job. Just watch and see. He was in prison when they sent for him. And he came out, he interpreted the dream, he brought a blueprint out of the dream. You might say, that was then. Jesus the same yesterday, today, and forever. It was the presence of God in his life that catapulted him into power. Not God fatherism, and not any political party. Genesis 41, 38 to 44. And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find such a one as this? A man in whom is the Spirit of God. This was before Christ came. The Spirit of God was in Joseph. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, inasmuch as God has shown you all this, there is no one as discerning and wise as you. You shall be over my house. He became father to Pharaoh. And all my people shall be ruled according to your word. Only in regard to the throne will I be greater than you. And Pharaoh said to Joseph, see, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh took his signet ring off his hand and put it on Joseph's hand. And he clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain around his neck. And he had him ride in the second chariot which he had, Air Force 2. And they cried out before him, bow the knee. So he set him over all the land of Egypt. Pharaoh also said to Joseph, I am Pharaoh. That day is around the corner in Nigeria and in all over Africa. I am Pharaoh. And without your consent, no man may lift his hand or his foot in all the land of Egypt. Brothers and sisters, do you know that the same God factor, the presence of God, was evident in the life of David and of Daniel? 1 Samuel chapter 16, 14 to 18. Let's check it out in the life of David. 1 Samuel 16, 14 to 18. But the spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, ex-anointed, and a distressing spirit from the Lord troubled him. And Saul's servant said to him, surely a distressing spirit from God is troubling you. Abba has gone mad. Let our master now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is a skillful player on the harp, and it shall be that he will play it with his hand when the distressing spirit from God is upon you, and you shall be well. So Saul said to his servants, provide me now a man who can play well and bring him to me. Then one of the servants answered and said, look, I have seen a son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite, who is skillful in playing, a mighty man of valor, a man of war. He had not joined the army. He was not part of the army. A man of war, prudent in speech, and a handsome person. Here is CV, and the Lord is with him. 1 Samuel 18, 12 to 16. 1 Samuel 18, 12 to 16. Now Saul was afraid of David. He had killed Goliath at this time, because the Lord was with him. Those who do not carry the presence of God will fear you, will be afraid of you, will talk ill of you, because they do not have what you have. Now Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him, but it had departed from Saul. Therefore Saul removed him from his presence, from being his armor bearer. It demoted him from being the chief of army staff. It demoted him to be a captain of this and a captain of that. But the guy did not worry himself. When his mentor became his tormentor, David trusted God, in whose presence he was and whose presence was in his life. Therefore, Saul removed him from his presence and made him his captain over 1,000. It doesn't matter where they remove you from. Just pray like David. Do not take your Holy Spirit away from me. Made him a captain over 1,000, and went out and came in before the people. And David behaved wisely in all his ways. When your mentor becomes your tormentor, behave yourself wisely. And the Lord was with him. Therefore, when Saul saw that he behaved very wisely, he was afraid of him. But all Israel and Judah loved David because he went out and came in before them. How about Daniel? Daniel chapter 6, verse 1 to 3. Daniel chapter 6, verse 1 to 3. It pleased Darius to set over the kingdom 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, he was primus inter pares. He was first among the equals. He was nullius secundus. He was second to none. And over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was first, that the princes might give accounts unto them, and the king should have no damage. Then this Daniel was preferred. Why? Above the presidents and princes, because an excellent spirit was in him, and the king thought to set him over the whole realm. While the king was thinking of setting him over the whole realm, there were others who were plotting and scheming. They all ended in the lion's den. Keep on plotting. Keep on scheming. Lions are getting angry. They are waiting for you. The day appointed of God's wrath upon your life is around the corner, because God will deliver this nation, no matter who thinks is in charge. Jehovah rules in the affairs of men and gives it to whosoever he wills. Watch out, because your days are numbered. Those of you who are pulling this nation down, don't think it will be like that forever. He's raising his Daniels. He's raising his Joseph. He's raising his Esthers. In the fullness of time, he will release them full swing into action. And this country will be changed and will become great in our lifetime, in the name of Jesus Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, the kings and queens of the earth, the presidents, the prime ministers, and the chancellors are now evidently perplexed with the current global pandemic. This is the golden opportunity for the church and for people within the church as solution providers to step in and show the way out of this present dilemma. This was what Joseph did when he gave the blueprint to Pharaoh for the economic survival of Egypt during a global recession. This was what David did when he killed Goliath and saved Israel from public disgrace and oppression by the Philistines in the battlefield, led by Goliath, their champion from God. If the church can get its acts together in this season as carriers of God's presence, if we can call upon God and receive from heaven the solution to this present and clear danger, then the current COVID-19 pandemic and the coming hunger pandemic will only end up in a major, mighty revival that will cause an upsurge in kingdom expansion. And that we will do by God's grace. Mark my words. How are we going to do it? Isaiah 59:19-21. So shall they fear the name of the Lord from the west, and his glory from the rising of the sun, the east, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. The Redeemer will come to Zion, and to those who turn from transgression in Jacob, says the Lord. As for me, says the Lord, this is the how-to. This is my covenant with them. My Spirit is upon you, and my words which I have put in your mouth shall not depart from your mouth, nor from the mouth of your descendants, nor from the mouth of your descendants, says the Lord, from this time forevermore. What is God saying here? I have a strategy. I need to put my Spirit upon you. I need my Spirit to be in you. I need for you to be led by the Spirit of the living God. Then I will put my word in your mouth so that you can declare things and I will establish them. When the Spirit of God is upon you, in you, all around you, envelopes you, and the word of God is in your mouth like a two-sharp edge, there is nothing that you cannot bring down, and there's nothing that cannot be raised even from rubble. When the Spirit of God is upon you, and his word is in your mouth, and in the mouth of your descendants, and descendants, Isaiah chapter 60 will come into play. When those two dimensions, the two dynamics of the word and the Spirit is upon you, the Bible is saying, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth. The darkest hour of the world is the finest moment for the church, will shine brighter and brighter. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles, those without God, shall come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes all around and see. They all gather together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, those in the diaspora, and your daughters shall be nurse at your side. No longer will they be victims of rape. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentiles, the wealth of the nations shall come to you. Give me verse 10 to 22. It's more than that. If you would dwell in the place God wants us to dwell, and he will put his Spirit in you, upon you, you have his manifest presence, and you have his indwelling presence, and you have his word in your mouth, the sons of foreigners shall build up your walls, and their kings shall minister to you. For in my wrath I struck you, but in my favor I've had mercy on you. Therefore your gates shall be open continually. They shall not be shut day or night, that men may bring to you the wealth of the nations, and their kings in procession. For the nation and kingdom which will not serve you shall perish, and those nations shall be utterly ruined. The glory of Lebanon shall come to you, the cypress, the pine, and the box tree together, to beautify the place of my sanctuary, and I will make the place of my feet glorious. Also the sons of those who are afflicted, you shall come bowing to you, and all those who despise you shall fall prostrate at the soles of your feet. Keep on abusing me. You will soon find out that my mother's maiden name is Ebudola, and will make wealth and honor out of your abuses. And they shall call you the city of the Lord, Zion of the Holy One of Israel. Whereas you have been forsaken and hated, so that no one went through you, I will make you an eternal excellence. This is what is going to happen to Nigeria, a joy of many generations. You shall drink the milk of the Gentiles and milk the breasts of kings. And you shall know that I, the Lord, am your Savior and your Redeemer, the Mighty One of Jacob. I'm giving you the portrait of the future. Instead of bronze, I'll bring gold. Upgrade operations. Instead of bronze, I'll bring gold. Instead of iron, I'll bring silver. Instead of wood, bronze. Instead of stones, iron. I will also make your officers peace and your magistrates righteousness. Violence shall no longer be heard in your land, neither wasting or destruction within your borders, but you shall call your walls salvation and your gates praise. The sun shall no longer be your light by day, nor for brightness shall the moon give light to you, but the Lord will be to you an everlasting light and your God your glory. Your sun shall no longer go down, nor shall your moon withdraw itself, for the Lord will be your everlasting light, and the days of your mourning shall be ended. May that be your portion tonight in the name of Jesus. Also, your people shall all be righteous. You can win by righteousness. They shall inherit the land forever, the branch of my planting, the work of my hands, that I may be glorified. And what will follow? A little one shall become a thousand, and a small one a strong nation. I, the Lord, will hasten it in its time. Give me Obadiah. I'm enjoying this. Obadiah 17. I'll read Obadiah 1. It's only one chapter, 17 and 18. And I'll go to verse 21. But on Mount Zion there shall be deliverance, and there shall be holiness. The house of Jacob shall possess their possessions. The house of Jacob shall be a fire, the house of Joseph a flame. But the house of Esau shall be stubble. All those who are operating in the flesh, Edom is flesh. But the house of Esau shall be stubble. They shall kindle them and devour them, and no survivor shall remain on the house of Esau. For the Lord has spoken. Verse 21. What will happen when Esau church is rubbish and taken out of the way? Then saviors, in the King James Version, he said, deliverers. Deliverers shall come to Mount Zion, to judge the mountain of Israel, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. As I begin to round up this message, giving up till 8:30, I'll be through. I'm enjoying myself. I hope you're enjoying the word too. As we begin to round up this message, it's important that we examine two more pillars erected by Jacob between and beyond Bethel, so that we can have a thorough grasp of the conceptual and operational definition of the church. Remember, when purpose is not known, abuse is inevitable. Last Wednesday, we identified the two pillars of Bethel. Jacob erected the first one, and we have read about it tonight also. He erected it and poured oil on it and called the place Bethel on his way to Laban's house in Paddan Aram. And he erected the other pillar and poured both wine and oil on it when he returned back to Bethel. Let's see both pillars of Bethel. The first one had oil, the second one had wine and oil. Genesis 28, 18 to 19. Then Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of that place Bethel, the house of God. But the name of that city had been loosed previously. The identity of that city changed in the realm of the spirit. The geography changed. It became the house of God because of the manifest presence of God. That was on his way to Paddan Aram. And when he returned, in Genesis 35 verse 1, God spoke to Jacob to return to Bethel. Listen to it. Then God said to Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there, and make an altar there to God who appeared to you when you fled from the face of Esau, your brother. And when he got there, he built an altar. He called that altar El Bethel, the God of the house. So it's one thing to have house of God. It's another thing to have the God of the house in his house. And in verse 9 to 15, then God appeared to Jacob again when he came from Paddan Aram and blessed him. And God said to him, your name is Jacob. Your name shall not be called Jacob anymore, but Israel shall be your name. So he called his name Israel. Also God said to him, I am God Almighty. Be fruitful and multiply. There's no diminishing returns in God. You're going to enjoy that very much so on July the 4th, when we have our one-day Dominion Partners Annual Conference. There's no diminishing returns in God. Famine should not decrease you. Be fruitful and multiply. A nation and a company of nations shall proceed from you, and kings shall come from your body. The land which I gave Abraham and Isaac, I give to you, and to your descendants after you, I give this land. Then God went off from him in the place where he talked with him. So Jacob set up a pillar, this is the second pillar of Bethel, in the place where he talked with him, a pillar of stone, and he poured a drink offering on it, and he poured oil on it. And Jacob called the name of the place where God spoke with him, Bethel. The consistency, on one was oil, on the other was both oil and wine. Why? That is the picture of the inn where Jesus took the wounded man on the road to Jericho. He poured wine first to disinfect the man, and he poured oil before he handed him over to the innkeeper and paid him 2 denarii, which is 2 days' wages, representing 2,000 years of the church age. A day with the Lord is like 1,000 years. 1,000 years is like a day. The church is where the wounded should come and be healed, not to be further wounded and taken advantage of. We saw the 2 pillars of Bethel, one with oil, anointed sons of God, the other with wine and oil, carriers of his healing anointing to the nations of the earth. However, in between these 2 pillars, there's one other pillar. And that pillar is very, very important. It will show you a core operational definition of the church. The patriarch Jacob called this pillar Galeed. Genesis 31, 22 to 29. Genesis 31, 22 to 29. And Laban was told on the third day that Jacob had fled. Then he took his brethren with him and pursued him for 7 days' journey. And he overtook him in the mountains of Gilead. But God had come to Laban the Syrian in a dream by night and said to him, "Be careful that you speak to Jacob, neither good nor bad." So Laban overtook Jacob. Now Jacob had pitched his tent in the mountains, and Laban with his brethren pitched in the mountains of Gilead. And Laban said to Jacob, "What have you done that you have stolen away unknown to me and carried away my daughters like captives taken with the sword? And why did you flee away secretly and steal away from me and not tell me? For I might have sent you away with joy and songs with timbrel and harp." Fathers in the church who cannot release their sons when the fullness of their time to go begin another work had begun, learn from this. You are a Laban. And the reason there is no more bloodshed within the church is because when the children have come to birth and there's no strength to bring forth, the next place is a Syrian operation. Stop it. "And you did not allow me to kiss my sons and my daughters." The church is not your property. It's God's church. You left somewhere to get to where you are. Why would you not let others fly? The sky is big to accommodate all. You have done foolishly in so doing. "It is in my power," Laban said. "They will curse you. They will do all kinds of things. It's in my power to do you harm. But the God of your father spoke to me last night saying, be careful that you speak to Jacob, neither good nor bad." When God comes on the scene, he does not take sides. He takes over. I like the response of the patriarch Jacob to him. 36 to 48. Genesis 31, 36 to 48. "Then Jacob was angry and rebuked Laban." That's when you become stronger than those who assume that you are under them forever. "Then Jacob was angry and rebuked Laban. And Jacob answered and said to Laban, 'What is my trespass? What is my sin that you have so hotly pursued me? Although you have searched all my things, what part of your household things have you found? Set it before my brethren and your brethren, that they may judge between us both. These 20 years have been with you. Your ewes and your female goats have not miscarried their young, have not eaten the rams of your flock. That which was torn by beasts, I did not bring to you. I bore the loss of it. You required it from my hand, whether stolen by day or stolen by night. There I was. In the day, the drought consumed me. You were in your living room watching television, whatever they watched in those days. And the frost by night, and my sleep departed from my eyes. Thus I've been in your house 20 years. I served you 14 years for your two daughters. They are no longer yours. I fully paid dowries for them. And 6 years for your flock. And you have changed my wages 10 times. Unless the God of my father, the God of Abraham and the fear of Isaac had been with me, surely now you would have sent me away empty-handed. How many of those sons who served in your ministry have you sent away empty-handed with curses? And right before your eyes, they are blossoming and flourishing. Remember a man of God who said, if that young boy does not die by end of 1989, then God has not called me. You shot yourself in the foot because we are barrier breakers. God has seen my affliction and the labor of my hands and rebuked you last night. And Laban answered and said to Jacob, these daughters are my daughters and these children are my children, Ekpeleo grandpa. This flock is my flock. All that you see is mine. But what can I do this day to these my daughters or to their children whom they are born? Now therefore, come, let us make a covenant. When your ways please the Lord, your enemies will become your well-wishers. Now therefore, come, let us make a covenant, you and I, and let it be a witness between you and me. So Jacob took a stone. Here is a pillar in between Bethel. So Jacob took a stone and set it up as a pillar. Then Jacob said to his brethren, gather stones. One is not enough, because we are going to be living stones unto him. Gather stones. And they took stones and made a heap. And they ate there on the heap. Laban called it Jegaz Hadutta, but Jacob called it Galeed. And Laban said, this heap is a witness. That's the meaning of the word Galeed. Witness. This heap is a witness between you and me this day. Therefore, its name is called Galeed. Brothers and sisters, both the pillar and the heap of stones gathered in this story were given one major name, Galeed, which means witness. If you don't know it, know it tonight. Our business is to witness. That is the tool we use to win souls. We are witnesses of his death, burial, resurrection, as we have studied. That was what Peter said to convict the people in Jerusalem in the day that Pentecost had fully come. He said, we are eyewitnesses. We are witnesses. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, Acts 1:8, and you shall be my witnesses. This is who we are, both the preacher, the pastor, the bishop, and the living stones in the church. We are witnesses. Witnessing can be done through publications such as books and tracts. You can write that down, Isaiah 52 verse 7, KJV. How beautiful upon the mountains, at the feet of him that bringeth good things, that publisheth peace. That's the word I'm looking for. That publisheth peace, that bringeth good tidings of good, that publisheth salvation, that saith unto Zion, your God reigns. You can publish through books, through tracts, through magazines. You'll still be witnessing with them. I remember a longtime friend of mine, Pastor Matthew Ashimolowo. The day he got born again, somebody gave him a tract, but he was drunk that day. He just put the tract in his pocket. I remember his testimony. He was totally drunk. He went home and went and got up the following day, perhaps with a headache, and started reading the tract, and the Spirit of God came upon him and convicted him, and see what the Lord has done through him today. Publishers of good news. It can be done also through preaching. Romans chapter 10, verse 12 to 15. Romans 10, 12 to 15. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich to all who call upon him. For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now watch this. How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed? How shall they believe in him on whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? Many have gone on a frolic of their own. You must be sent. As it is written, is now referring to Isaiah that we just quoted. How beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. However, the most effective type of witnessing is lifestyle evangelism. When your very life attracts people to God, this happens when your conduct, through your conduct or by your conduct, you attract others to Christ instead of just preaching to them or preaching at them. Zechariah chapter 8, 20 to 23. Thus says the Lord of hosts, this is what I'm expecting to happen to us after COVID-19 pandemic has gone. No matter how long it stays for, we are more than conquerors. We are going to overcome this pandemic in the name of Jesus. People shall yet come, inhabitants of many cities. The inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us continue to go and pray before the Lord. A new season is about to break forth on us, and seek the Lord of hosts. I myself will go also. And what's going to happen? Yes, many peoples and strong nations shall come to the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem, the house of peace, and to pray before the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, in those days, 10 men from every language of the nations shall grasp the sleeve of a Jewish man, saying, let us go with you. Why? For we have heard that God is with you, that you are a carrier of God's glory and presence. So they will follow you because the presence of God has become clearly evident in your life. Listen to Peter the apostle in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Is given some clarification about what the church really is and what they are supposed to do, just as Paul defined it to Timothy. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people, King James Version calls it peculiar people, that you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Beloved, I beg you, it was pleading with the church, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, those who know that their stay here is not forever, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly laws which war against the soul, having your conduct, that's it, lifestyle evangelism, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, those without God, those without Christ, those without hope in this world, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may by your good works which they observe glorify God in the day of visitation when God visits them also. And in 1 Peter chapter 3, he made it so beautiful there that wives who have husbands who are like Nabal should just conduct themselves well. They'll be able to win over the souls of their sons and by their conduct. Wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word, without you speaking anything, may be won by the conduct of their wives. When they observe your chaste conduct, accompanied by fear. That's reverence. That's honor. Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold, or putting on fine apparel. Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart, with the incorruptible beauty, the one outside, will one day fade, with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands, as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are. You are no longer daughters of Eve. If you are in faith, you are now daughters of Sarah, who obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are, if you do good and not afraid with any terror. Husbands, likewise, dwell with them with understanding. That's revelation knowledge there. He said in King James Version, deal with them according to knowledge, giving honor to the wife. The wife you don't honor cannot submit to you. As to the weaker vessel, that's not mean they're weak. No, they are to be treated like fragile object, to be honored, to be protected as weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. So for so many of you men, it's not Satan hindering your prayers, it's the way you have been treating your spouse. Finally, all of you be of one mind, having compassion for one another, love as brothers, be tender-hearted, be cautious, not returning evil for evil, or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, blessing, knowing that you are called to this, that you may inherit a blessing. For he who would love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. This is lifestyle evangelism. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. His ears are open to their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And who is he who will harm you if you become followers of what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you are blessed. And do not be afraid of your threats, nor be troubled. Why? But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Verse number 16. Having a good conscience, that when they defame you as evildoers, those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed. Wow. Wow. May we all become ambassadors of Christ, men of character, men of integrity, women of character, women of integrity, noble women whose lives and attitudes and character can attract the ungodly to Christ in the name of Jesus. Now, let me quickly finish with the final pillar. You have seen the pillar of witness. This final one is so critical, because this one is going to knock bottom out of everyone who thinks we are going to live and die in Bethel. God said to Joshua, to Jacob, arise and go to Bethel and dwell there. They think he was to stay there forever. No, there's journey from Bethel. The final pillar erected by the patriarch Jacob is the one on the tomb of Rachel. This was erected when he journeyed beyond Bethel to the Tower of Eder. Genesis chapter 35, verse 1. Again, let's read. Then God said to Jacob, arise, go up to Bethel and dwell there. That's the concern, the passion of so many people. We must go to Bethel. We must dwell in Bethel. And make an altar there to God who appeared to you when you fled from your face of Esau, from the face of Esau, your brother. Now in verse 16, let's see what happened. Then the journey from Bethel. Can you underline that there's a journey from Bethel, that we are going beyond Bethel, beyond house of God, to become in his house. And when there was but a little distance to go to Ephrath, that's Bethlehem, Rachel labored in childbirth, and she had hard labor. Now it came to pass when she was in hard labor that the midwife said to her, do not fear, you have this son also. And so it was, as her soul was departing, for she died, that she called his name Ben-Oni, son of my sorrow. But his father called him Benjamin, son of my right hand. Why was this happening? Because Benjamin is a type and shadow of the Lord Jesus Christ, a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief, who will finish his ministry here and be seated on the right-hand side of the Father. Where was he born? Benjamin was born in Bethlehem. That's why Mary and Joseph had to go to Bethlehem, because they were following a script already written by the Lord. So Rachel died and was buried on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. And Jacob set a pillar on a grave, which is the pillar of Rachel's grave to this day. Now remember, two pillars of Bethel, one with oil, the first one, and the other one with wine and oil. But between these two pillars was Galilee, the operational definition of the church, witnessing. And now they went from Bethel and they came to Bethlehem. But on the way, as they were getting to Bethlehem, as Rachel was given birth, she died. And Jacob erected a pillar on her grave. The significance of that pillar is simple. This is death to self. This is where we are separated from everything and everyone that we inadvertently love above and beyond our God. Until Rachel died and was buried, and this pillar was erected on her grave, Jacob could not proceed to the Tower of Eder. Brothers and sisters, we are not destined to dwell and die in Bethel. There's a journey beyond Bethel. When we die to self, our operational place will become the Tower of Eder, the Tower of the Flock. This tower is synonymous with the mountains of the Lord's house that's on top of all the mountains and above all the hills of culture by whatsoever nomenclature. Genesis 35, 19 to 21. Genesis 35, 19 to 21. So Rachel died and was buried on the way to Ephrath, that is Bethlehem. And Jacob set a pillar on her grave, which is the pillar of Rachel's grave to this day. Then Israel journeyed and pitched his tent beyond the Tower of Eder. The Tower of Eder, if you look in the middle column of your Bible, it was the Tower of the Flock. Where is this tower? Micah chapter 4. Let's see the prophecy of Micah. Chapter 4, beginning from verse 1 to 8. Now it shall come to pass in the latter days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established on the top of the mountains and shall be exalted above the hills, and people shall flow to it. Many nations shall come and say, come, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways, and we shall walk in his paths. For out of Zion the Lord shall go forth, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between many peoples, and rebuke strong nations afar off. Are they not being rebuked by just ordinary virus now? They shall beat their swords into plowshares. Weapons of war will be turned into weapons of producing food, and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. But everyone shall sit under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one shall make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of hosts has spoken. For all the people, watch this, God is not intimidated by other gods in this world. For all the people walk, each in the name of his God, but will work. They walk in the name of his God, small letter G-O-D, but we will work in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. In that day, says the Lord, in the day that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be on top of the mountains and above all hills, in that day, says the Lord, I will assemble the lame. I will gather the outcasts and those whom I have afflicted. I will make the lame a remnant and the outcasts a strong nation. So the Lord will reign over them in Mount Zion from now on, even forever. Where is the mountain of Eder? Where is the Tower of Eder? And you, O Tower of the Flock, there you find it, the Tower of Eder, the stronghold of the daughter of Zion. To you shall it come. What is going to come to you? Even the former dominion shall come, the kingdom of the daughter of Jerusalem. The tower is synonymous with the mountain of the Lord's house that's on top of all the mountains, above all the hills. This is the spiritual location of the church without walls. This is the church operating on the mountain of the Lord's house, which is above all mountains, above all hills. It is in this elevated place like Ramah, and you'll learn more about that at the communion table of the Lord on Friday. It is in this elevated place like Ramah that we can infiltrate and influence the kingdoms of this world, to the end that we also are able to infuse the culture of the kingdom of God into every domain of human endeavor. When God raised up Esther and Mordecai, the fear of them descended upon people that they naturalized, they became Jews. Why? God had lifted them up. We are getting to that place when God will put a difference between those who serve him and those who do not serve him. Someone may ask, at what time and in what season are we likely to operate on the seven mountains of culture? Without any doubt in my mind, I believe with all my heart that that period began from January 1, 2020, like never before. I will say why I'm saying that. Habakkuk gave us a clear indicator as to when the mountain of the Lord's house will be on top of all mountains and when we can begin to operate on the mountains of culture. Like Joseph in Egypt, it is in the midst of economic recession and political turmoil that generate social, economic, and political inversion, so that those who are first shall be last, and those who are last shall be first. It's already happening in our climb. Where do we see this? Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17 to 19. Habakkuk 3, 17 to 19. though the fig tree may not blossom, economic decline, nor fruit be on the vines, though the labor of the olive may fail, and the fields yield no food, though the flock may be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will joy in the God of my salvation. The Lord God is my strength. He will make my feet like deer's feet, and he will make me walk on my high heels. Those are not high heel shoes. Those are the mountains of culture. To the chief musician with my stringed instrument. Give me the same passage in the Message translation. Habakkuk 3:17-19 in the Message translation. Listen to this. Though the cherry trees don't blossom, and the strawberries don't ripen, though the apples are worm eaten, and the wheat fields stunted, though the sheep pens are sheepless, and the cattle barns empty, I'm singing joyful praise to God. Why? I'm turning cartwheels of joy to my Savior, counting on God's rule to prevail. I take heart and gain strength. I run like a deer. I feel like I am king of the mountain. I feel like I'm king of the mountain. In the midst of economic decline, in the midst of pandemic, this is the finest moment for the church. Let the joy of the Lord rise up within you, for the joy of the Lord is your strength, and begin to praise him, because there will be no crown without battles. There will be no testimonials and testimonies without tests and trials. We are going through. It's not our final bus stop. Though we pass through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil. And when we come out of it, goodness, hallelujah, will follow me all the days of my life. Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'll be the house of the Lord wherever I am. Here is my parting shirt. Please ask the Lord for your own appointed mountain today as I round up my stewardship, a Bible study. Others are taking over from me from next Wednesday by God's grace. I want you to ask the Lord for your own appointed mountain. Matthew chapter 28, verse 16 to 20. Matthew 28, 16 to 20. Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted, just as some of you will be doubting tonight. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me where? In heaven and on earth. Does that include Nigeria? Yes. Does that include America? Yes. Does that include China? Yes. All over the world. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. What do you understand by this text? It is very clear from this text that your effectiveness in matters of global evangelism and impact is contingent upon your appointed mountain. He spoke to them on the appointed mountain. My heart desire and fervent prayer to God is for him to take you to the top of your career, the top of your profession, the top of your trade, and the top of your business endeavor, so that as you become kings of the mountain, the opportunity for you to influence the world for God will grow exponentially. Remember that through him we have received grace and apostleship for the obedience to the faith among all nations for his name's sake. And by the grace of God, I will see you at the top, because I'm going higher. And in the mighty name of Jesus, you will be higher too. God will elevate you. I'll see you at the top in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen.